I'll start the case. So I'm just going to give a case and probably open it to the house, and then we'll have the experts to moderate the entire session. So we had a patient referred from the ophthalmologist, a 24 years female, who presented with a sudden loss of half sight of vision in the left eye. There was no headache, the CT scan was normal, and systemic examination was normal.
Half sight of vision.
Past history of two spontaneous pregnancy loss. An ophthalmic diagnosis was given of partial retinal artery thrombosis, minimal hemorrhage, and a pale disc. So first, I would like to open a question as to in what direction everybody's thinking, and what are the best tests to advise to evaluate the patient.
Anti-phospholipid antibody.
Sure. Yeah, I think.
Okay. I think I would approach it in a slightly different way. See, if you look at it, that the person has got branch retinal artery occlusion, and if you look at it, what is the commonest cause of it? The commonest cause of it is an atheroembolic stroke from the carotid, but that is in people who are 70 years and above. So that is unlikely, because this is at 35, na?
24.
Okay. So that is very, very unlikely. But among the age is usually the biggest clue. Among the people who are less than 40 years, the commonest is cardioembolic. So 50% of these people are likely to come from the heart, even though it is a branch, if either a complete or a branch. So the most important test which I'll do is a simple chest X-ray, ECG, and a 2D echocardiography. That is my number one test which has to be done. Then if you look at the other causes which can lead to this thing, you can have lot of developmental anomalies. See, such a small one which has gone to this thing, something like, you know, maybe a dissection of the carotid and some rarer diseases like Moyamoya disease and all, what they say. So for that, I would like to get a carotid Doppler done. That is my second test which I would like to done. The third is, if I look at, there are hematological diseases like sickle cell anemia or even a sickle beta thal trait which can remain asymptomatic, may just come with some splenomegaly and HB of 9 or something. That can also cause it. So the third thing which I would like to look at is HBTLC, DLC, a peripheral blood smear, clinically look for a spleen, possibly do a hemoglobin electrophoresis to see I should not miss out on a sickle cell trait or a sickle cell anemia. The fourth condition is that diseases like leukemias and lymphomas, they may be associated with things like, you know, they can come with leukostasis affecting this thing. So also diseases which can have thrombocytosis can come, this may be the first presentation. So needless to say, HBTLC, DLC specifically, and to see whether TLC is high or this thing, they are very important. So in fact, because these are so much more easier to do, they would, number one, come at a much more commoner thing than looking for an exotic thrombophilia workup. First rule is that. Then now we come down to, after we have ruled out all these things, if you have to look at a thrombophilia, then like to see whether it's an inherited or an acquired kind of a stuff. There, obviously, we would like to see all the standard things. Very interesting thing is, see, most of your classical, the arterial ones are only 2-3, antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, hyperhomocysteinemia. Since this is a retinal artery occlusion, these, the weightage of these would be very high. Most of the deep vein thrombosis and all are the ones associated with antithrombin 3, protein C, protein S deficiency. But interestingly, when it comes to the brain and the eyes, even they have been shown to be associated, though not as strongly. In the lower limb, one should not think, if you ever have a digital gangrene, don't waste your time by doing protein C, protein S deficiency, because that is an artery. Only for vein we should do. But when it comes to the eye, it is worth possibly looking at that angle also. So after I've looked at that, the two abortions
exactly, yeah,
look exciting, but remember the commonest cause of abortion is a bad fetus. In fact, that is your nature's way of ensuring that the child is never born. So if you look at the studies in gynecology textbooks and see what is the maximum number of aborted fetus, possibly 50-60% of them are likely to have cytogenetic abnormalities. That is your nature ensuring that the child never comes into this world. And there are so many other causes of abortion. Though it looks very exciting to say an antiphospholipid antibody syndrome, it is a possibility, but it's not too exciting a possibility.
So this particular symptom does not add weight in the context? Is that
marginally,
what
it does. marginally, I will say, because the point is that see, we being immunologists, we remember APLA, we remember recurrent pregnancy loss, and tagak we jump. No, wrong. Commoners, the reason for this thing is something else. It can also occur kind of a stuff. So like I mentioned, we would like to go through the standard thing, 2D echocardiography, carotid Doppler, HPTLC, DLC, looking for sickle beta thal, looking for leukemias and lymphomas, then looking for prothrombotic workup. That would be my approach.
Thank you, sir.
You expand your spontaneous pregnancy class a little more, probably a little more.
What,
yes.
What trimester
both the pregnancy
loss? See, when
you
think of cytogenetic abnormalities loss, pregnancy loss, usually it is the first trimester pregnancy loss, which is mainly because of cytogenetic abnormalities. If it is the second trimester, then the immunological causes are much more commoner than the cytogenetic abnormalities.
Which trimester was?
They are second trimester. Dr. Shankar has made my job lighter, actually. I mean, that's the best way of thinking process which is required. Of course, those informations has been put across, but it's in a little more hidden format. So we have clearly said that the systemic examination normal, which included the vascular study, vessel observation, etc., where all the carotid arteries were fine, CVS examination was normal, and she didn't have a headache to suggest a possible clogging. Because, as you said, one of the other reasons which we need to seriously consider is a hematological abnormality, which is quite more commoner. And she's a 24-year-old female, so that being the atherosclerosis and other complications are less frequent. All other things has to be looked in. So to put it, probably as you said, the next slide. Next slide. So what we just suggested at this point of time was the CBC-ESR. One other important thing which we forgot to discuss it, that was a vasculitis, which can also sometime resemble an arterial block, a single arterial block. So to keep that possibility, the CRP, C3 and C4, and ANA, APLA work antibodies, including lupus anticoagulant. So this is the basic simple workup which should be suggested to begin with. Next. In CBC, hemoglobin happened to be 10.5 grams, total count was 12,000, platelet was 2,50,000, with peripheral smear, everything was normal. So, go ahead.
This was the report. The IgG was 9 GPL, the IgM was 2, and IgA was 3 APL units. The lupus anticoagulant, I think the screen was 51.2. And the ratio was normal. I think it was in the normal range.
Let's comment on that.
Here, the DRVVT screen, it is basically the DRVVT which is done directly, which is showing a higher value with about 51.2 seconds. The reference range is about 31 to 4. Control would have been normal, I presume. And then the mixing studies, which is done basically wherein you take, mix up the sample of a normal sample along with the DRVVT, there it has shown that there is a correction which has occurred, that is there is 43 seconds, and the DRVVT confirm is a DRVVT with excess of phospholipids which has been added to it, which has again corrected it. So basically it has now got corrected. So it shows that the DRVVT is high, but which is being corrected. So possibly it is positive. What would you say for this actually? I mean, rather than last time.
Any inference on this basis? So you see, the basic one thing which I am facing, you know, why I took this case in addition was, I do frequently see this report being interpreted quite frequently from the lab, which is often wrong, but it has to be, end game is, when it comes back to the clinician table, he has to say whether lab has given it a right or wrong. Because lab may escape saying that, no, by oversight I made an error. But in the end game, it's a clinician who need to explain to the patient what really went wrong. So it's at best to understand these set of tests, whether to call it positive, call it negative, what the laboratory has sent you as a report as a LA positive, LA negative, would you like it to be with the persons, I mean with the lab, what they are saying? Because this is very crucial, because this is an interpretation of all these tests is the end game to say that yes, it is positive or negative.
So be negative.
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, because I would expect yes. it to, even after
exact.
Phospholipid,
yes.
but expected it to remain
yes.
as
a high. So the, because, no, when you correct with phospholipids, actually usually if it is getting corrected, it indicates it's positive. But here, as far as the mixing studies has got, that has got rectified again. So probably this is somewhere we'll have to calculate the ratio. The ratio is not given here. So
1.2.
Okay. So it is a borderline. I mean, case where probably there could be a chance of the patient having been on anticoagulants. So that could sometimes cause it to be a positive, false kind, positive kind of a picture which could give.
What level you have to give significant? See, if the mix criteria, the first mix doesn't get corrected, the second one confirmed test gets corrected. Lupus
but it is positive.
Present.
It is lupus anticoagulant positive.
Clear.
Yes.
In this kind of situation, you give us a ratio. This ratio gives sometimes one cutoff is 1.1. Not only you, I mean all the labs.
Yeah.
Then makes us weekly positive is whether to consider as positive
see,
or
basically
not.
Basically, what happens many a times if we don't have a complete history. So we don't know whether the patient is on anticoagulants or what is it. Sometimes the anticoagulants could give a false positive LA, and when you do a ratio, suppose if it is more than 2, then I'm very clear it is strong positive. And then again, if I want, if a confirm is also not getting corrected, and then we do a mixing studies and then it is getting corrected, we would think it is LA positive. In addition to the LA being positive, the patient is having anticoagulants being taken. So if the confirm was getting corrected by the mixing studies. But
the patient is not on anticoagulant.
If the patient is not on anticoagulant, probably you should take it as positive. But then there could be LA could be positive, and sometimes you do get false positive results. So best is to repeat it after 6 weeks at least.
This is one of the crucial things which you need to remember.
Because this LA sometimes there is a confusion, and that's what we thought. Next.
Sir, I want some clarification on the previous slide. Because the picture, the previous two slides, it looks like more an embolic phenomena. I am not able to understand what exactly you are thinking. You are thinking in terms of systemic lupus erythematosus or vasculitis, because the clinical presentation is only ophthalmic symptoms and there is no other clinical symptoms
correct.
At all.
See,
so what makes you think directly it is vasculitis or a systemic lupus, because the total clinical picture is not given or represented only with the ophthalmic
symptoms? No, we have not said it is...
I think I'll correct, I mean, I'll clarify the doubt here. See, we are not thinking it in terms of systemic lupus erythematosus or anything. Antiphospholipid antibodies is a independent entity, independent of SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus. APLA, these are the autoantibodies which can exist independent of SLE, though somehow we use a word called lupus anticoagulant. It got that name because it was first described in a SLE patient. So it continued to be, and it is a total misnomer to call it as, we call it as lupus anticoagulant. Unfortunately, what it does is it's a
procoagulant.
It actually promotes thrombosis rather than an anticoagulant. So it's a total misnomer. Lupus is also a misnomer, anticoagulant is also a misnomer. But unfortunately, once you name a test, it cannot be changed. It's like rheumatoid factor. Rheumatoid factor, we thought it's an exclusive sole thing which is to be seen in rheumatoid arthritis. But we do see it in every other condition. So, but the name goes. Name cannot be changed.
No, lupus anticoagulant is basically a coagulation test which you start suspecting when the APTT is prolonged. Once the APTT is prolonged, at that time you do a workup for, in addition to the other factor deficiencies, you also think in terms of a lupus anticoagulant and you look for it, whether it's a thrombotic disorder or is it a defect basically because of the coagulation factor deficiency. So that is how you work up and come to a lupus anticoagulant when you're doing this thing. As he said, it is just a misnomer. It has got nothing to do with systemic lupus erythematosus.
No, it can present. There is something what is called as isolated retinal vasculitis. And like what we earlier, Dr. Shankar was discussing, there is something called isolated CNS vasculitis. The vasculitis can be so regionalized and it can affect only that vessels. There are patients where the vasculitis continues to affect the eye after he loses vision, it may not affect any other organ. It can just get localized to the eye. So isolated retinal vasculitis is a well-described entity. So the possibility of that should be always kept in mind. So that was the reason why we said that it's always best to screen that as one of the possibilities.
Here, her lupus was actually giving a positive. She has already on anticoagulants, because once there was an embolic disorder, she was given a dosage of oral anticoagulants.
Next.
What next? Actually, I think this was sort of missed out in the initial part. So, the family history of father having an acute myocardial infarction at the age of 45, and he was a non-smoker. A paternal uncle had a similar sort of scenario where he had a CVA at 50 years and he was a non-smoker too. The paternal aunts, three of them, are all normal and healthy in the 40s. The maternal side has no significant clinical history, and two uncles at 50s were normal. So they had this particular paternal history. So would this change anything?
Yeah. Yes, the one possibility is good.
They mentioned that the arterial ones classically are either MACLA or microhomocysteinemia. Now you're telling me that two of his this thing, so homocysteine is worth knowing.
So I think this makes us clear that actually whenever we see a patient, younger patient, with a thrombosis, even including an young MI, young strokes, and any patients who comes with an early thromboembolic process, talk about as thrombophilia. The recent study which has been done by Institute of Thrombophilia, I think hopefully many of you may not be knowing, this institute is Indian counterpart of a London Institute of Thrombophilia, is in Bangalore, and it's doing quite a good of work with reference to the thrombophilia in our region, has shown there is a significant, very high incidence of thrombophilia even in Indian scenario. The incidence of thrombophilia of hereditary nature is quite significant and needs to be attention, especially they have surveyed at Mandya district and few sample population. They do suggest that there is a little increased incidence of thrombophilia in these population. Probably that is one of the reason you may be seeing some of the young MIs, young strokes, especially from Mandya district. We do find quite a good number of people running from this area with an younger strokes and MIs. So when we further went into looking was this, we searched for CS, antithrombin 3, factor 5 laden and homocysteine, but there are quite a long list of the causes for hereditary thrombophilia, but these are the five commonest cause which are responsible in the population. All others are relatively rare, but there is one entity which is more common in European population is the fibrinogen mutation, which is not very commonly seen as per the survey which is conducted. So usually we avoid using that test unless we don't find anything in this.
Prothrombin
G mutation. Next.
This was what the results showed. Protein C was 89%, antithrombin 3 was 110%, factor 5 laden was 1.8, and homocysteine was 11 micromole, but there was a significant sort of a deficiency in protein S.
The protein S values normally are about 65 to 110, and this patient had a protein S of only 25%. So basically she had a protein S deficiency. And this condition, though we think is so uncommon, we do come across, we actually have quite a few cases with protein S deficiency which is there with us. And but we don't usually go for a workup immediately, a complete workup. First we look for the acquired, if at all, when you're having the symptoms or you're doing an APLA, thrombophilia workup. We do an antiphospholipid antibody work initially. In case it's negative and you still strongly suspect that it is positive, then we go in for a hereditary thrombophilia workup, and this is what, with a history of retinal artery occlusion, spontaneous abortions, family history of MI.
1.8 ratio, what does it mean? Normal.
Factor 5 laden, yes.
1.2 and above is normal. It's actually the ratio between the test done and test done
deficient
with the deficient plasma.
Factor 5 laden.
And the ratio of that should be above 1.2.
I'd just like to ask a question regarding the genetics of this particular disease here. We see that the other females in the family are unaffected. with the, it's been a predominantly male sort of favoring disease, when she's the first female in the family. Is there some sort of a?
No, it's basically an autosomal recessive, not on the sex chromosome. It is actually, the problem here is that it's a, these factor deficiency have a variable penetration. That's one of the biggest problem with this. And you do see in a same family with the gene being present, someone with 20%, someone with 40%, someone with 70%. And usually we do find a patient with 40-60% not having any problem at all. I think I have a doctor family who is there,
clustering.
Who's the father, who's also a physician, who had his MI at the age of 70, but his factor status was 45%. He survived up to 70 without any problem. Whereas his daughter, she also happens to be a doc at this point. She has a recurrent pregnancy wastage with a protein deficiency somewhere around 30%. In a sense, it has a very variable penetrance when it comes to the presentation.
Sir, how do you relate this to the loss of pregnancies?
It's a well-described entity that the factor defects can produce recurrent pregnancy wastage, basically because of the thrombosis occurring at the placental area, because of the, more or less similar to APLA syndrome, where thrombosis occurs at placental interface and causes an abortion.
Placental ischemia will lead to
placental thrombosis ischemia. And ischemia. Yes,
and
sir.
It's very common actually, placental tissue to get ischemia.
And sir, I do get these and investigations. Pardon, madam.
No, actually, even when we see the specimen also, we'll find alternate areas of hemorrhagic infarct with viable areas in a, whenever we do a placental studies on these cases, thrombophilia workups.
So in DVTs, we get these investigations done routinely. And of course, there is a treatment for hyperhomocysteinemia. But as far as my knowledge goes, I don't know what is the treatment for this protein C deficiency antithrombin.
Okay.
Is there any treatment?
No, I'll just put it like this. See, the basic issue, that is why you need to know the reason for the DVT is, see, if it is an antiphospholipid antibody syndrome which is responsible for the deep vein thrombosis, prophylaxis is for lifetime. So you need to put the patient on oral anticoagulant for lifetime. If it happens to be because of protein S or protein C deficiency, their anticoagulation recommended by the international guidelines is, if it is between 30 to 60, normally oral anticoagulation is recommended for first 6 months, and subsequently just to put them an aspirin and keep a watch and anticoagulate them with heparin only during crashes. That is, if they go for a prolonged bed rest, or they have a fracture, or they have to go through some surgery, where they have to be under bed rest for a longer time. That's the time to put them
in
on.
In DVTs, pardon me to interfere. In DVTs, aspirin has got no role.
No. What I'm saying is, as a lifelong prophylaxis for a relapse. See, what is the principle behind this is, in a protein S or protein C deficiency, usually the relapse of a thrombosis in a patient who has between 30 to 60%, the chance is said to be only around 1 to 2%. When that's the case, in a de novo thrombosis is being low, recommended oral anticoagulation is only for the 6 months from the index DVT time, and subsequently just to keep them an aspirin to prevent if there is any help is there. There is no rationale further, but that has been gone as a practice to give these patients an aspirin for the rest of the lifetime to prevent further cardiovascular damages or injuries. When it is below 30%, the recommendation is to go once again like APLA syndrome, where the oral anticoagulant is continued for the lifetime. They have to be on oral anticoagulant from the index of clotting for the rest of the lifetime. Suppose if you find a person by a family screening who has 25% or 30% less, there is no guidelines at this point whether we should put them on oral anticoagulant or we have to just leave them. At the present, most of the practice is not to give any oral anticoagulant unless they thrombose. But it's an unfortunate scenario, but the risk of oral anticoagulant is said to be much more higher than not giving them oral anticoagulant. So risk to benefit ratio puts us, the epidemiological study wise, that yes, the oral anticoagulant is not recommended considering the group. But if you come from the patient, if he gets a clot, probably we made a mistake, but that's how we have to work in medical science.
And sir, what is the INR that is to be maintained in these cases? In
here,
cardiac patients, we usually maintain it between 2.5 and 3.5. In such cases, what is the INR?
See, in APLA, we require INR to be very high. It should be between 2.5 to 3.5. Mm-hmm. Whereas here, it is on the lesser side. You can keep it just at 2.5. You better not shoot above 3. Because the tendency of these patients bleeding is much higher than APLA patients. The APLA patients' procoagulation is very high compared to this set of patients. If you look into the epidemiology of relapses, 60% is the chance of a relapse in APLA if you don't anticoagulate them, whereas here it is around 3 to 5%. So the bleeding tendency is very high with these patients.
Thank you.
So I have two questions. One is, like in a previous case where you have strong suspicion of APLS, if ACL and LAC are negative or doubtful positive, what is the role of doing antibodies to beta-2 glycoprotein inhibitors? Second one is, many times due to financial reasons, we are not able to do LAC directly. If APTT is normal, can we categorically rule out LAC? Or still we can go ahead, there is strong suspicion, if APTT is normal?
No, actually, if you are clinically strongly suspecting antiphospholipid antipas and APLA is...
It depends on the kind of APTT you are using. There are different types of APTT. And there are some APTTs which are more sensitive to the lupus anticoagulant. So what many of the labs call them a screen LA actually. But they are not actually lupus anticoagulant what they are doing. What they are doing is basically a APTT. So if a APTT is absolutely no,
actually
normal,
the, you know, the whatever the chart that has come from the latest recommendation from IHRC, International Hematology Societies, it says that if APTT is normal, if you are clinically not very seriously not suspecting APLA, you can
stop
there.
At that. That's
but if you are very strongly suspecting clinically, if ACLA, both IgG, IgM and IgA and even beta 2 glycoprotein is negative, then you can go ahead in proving and disproving that LA is negative. Because APTT can still be normal in a very small percentage of patients. So almost if a normal APTT, it rules out a possibility of lupus anticoagulant. But if your suspicion is too strong, you always recommend it to go ahead with that particular. That's the chart how it goes like. Strong suspicion, still go ahead with doing the test. If not strongly suspected, stop there. Positive predictive value, if your possibility is too low, then you can stop there actually. I hope I'm clear on that.
Both ACL and LAC are negative, like in the previous case. Can we go ahead with beta 2 GPA? Will it antibodies to beta 2 glycoprotein?
The current kits are available are, though we call it as anticardiolipin, they are all
beta 2 glycoprotein
hybrids. You now don't get a isolated cardiolipin coated plates. So in a conclusion, actually, we just consider it as a proteinase deficiency and need oral anticoagulation at least for 6 months to be followed up. And probably when she goes for a next pregnancy, she needs a low molecular weight heparin through pregnancy to for the pregnancy to be successful through.
Thank you. I now request Dr. Renuka to come on for the next presentation.
This case is a little bit of a deviation from all your rheumatic cases. So basically, I thought there would be quite a bit of PGs over here. Maybe I could just put it across. This came up just 3 days back. We got this case. So this was, I didn't get any history. What I just got was a sample of a 6-year-old girl with which had been sent for hemoglobin electrophoresis. And this is what I have got. Then we gave back a call to them, and this is the history that I have got. A six-year-old girl presented with anemia and failure to thrive. Clinically, she had nothing but just anemia, hepatosplenomegaly, and all other systems were normal. That is what the clinician has given me the information. And so when we got the hemoglobin, we got the blood for EDTA sample. We did a blood count on that sample, just done on a 5-part. As a protocol, whenever a sample comes for HB electrophoresis, we also do a smear and we see that. And in addition to that, we also do a CBC count. So the hemoglobin was really low, 4.6 gram per deciliter. The RBC count was low. Total counts were low. And MCV was very low, 54.4. Platelets were normal. Peripheral smear showed a microcytic hypochromic picture with target cells and quite a bit of fragmented RBCs, polychromasia was there and nucleated RBCs. I don't have a, pardon? Retic was not done actually, because basically the sample had come only for HB electrophoresis. So just before we do the interpretation, we make a habit to smear. It wasn't asked for, maybe it would have been high. So definitely, because looking at the smear itself, I am sure, because once there is a polychromasia and NRBCs in the circulation, that means RDW range is very high. So that, now what do you think, whenever you are doing a workup for a microcytic anemia, what would you think just looking at the smear?
At this, it should look like a thalassemia or a thalassemia. See the difference in terms of iron deficient anemia and thalassemia, lead poisoning with the same.
Fine.
So since target cells are hypochromic with such a severe HB, it will go with thal. But the TLC is 3150, which is low.
Yes.
So I would suspect that there is a secondary folate deficiency which has developed,
okay,
because of increased amount of hemolysis which is occurring, and that possibly, so in the bone marrow, I wouldn't be surprised if a bone marrow was done. There may be some, you know, secondary folate deficiency can lead to ineffective erythropoiesis and get the TLC down.
Yes.
And the polychromasia and the REW wide, everything goes in favor of a hemolysis.
It goes in favor of a hemolysis, but the RDW being,
because of,
but the RDW being so high, we would also start thinking in terms of an iron deficiency anemia. See, when it's a microcytic hypochromic blood picture, RDW is not very high in a case of a.
There are two more clues. One is, if it is a pure iron deficiency, I would not expect the TLC to be 3160. Number one. Number two, target cells again is a little odd point. The third point is the presence of a lymphocytosis of 47.8% makes me suspect that she has gone into a hemolytic crisis possibly.
No, lymphocyte 47% is normal for
actually
a 6-year-old.
Actually, Polly is 41. So
six-year-old girl, the lymphocytes will be higher than the polychromatosis.
See, lymph is more than poly.
Yeah, I'll just show you the HB pattern as it is straight, and you can just do the interpretation. So this is the hemoglobin which we had got. The hemoglobin electrophoresis was done for this case. This came on just this 4-5 days back, as I said. These are the normal controls, and this is the samples which we have run 3 times, because first time when we got it, we got an abnormal pattern. Then that's when we got the history, re-ran the sample, and when we are running the strip, we ran another 2-3 on the same strip actually. So what this is basically, when you do the interpretation, this is HbA1, this is a normal sample, and this is the HbA2 level, and what you get here is the HbF. So this was the pattern. So in a normal, of course, HbA1 was high, HbF2 was very minimal, and here it's little different. So HbA2 is literally not there. What I'm finding here is HbF and HbA2. We have done the analysis of this. So what we have felt was that hemoglobin F was 29% and hemoglobin A2 was 71%. Now what do you think of it? It is a hemoglobinopathy. If you are thinking of, then yes, what kind of a hemoglobinopathy would you think? Anybody? Okay.
Little tough for a regular clinical.
See. No, but no, even if not this, maybe just if you look at this, in HB, see normally, I will just tell you this much, normally HbA1 is 95% to 98%, HbA2 is 1.5% to 3.5%, and HbF is less than 2%. In our case, we had 71% of HbA2 and 29% of HbF.
What kind of picture you get in beta thal this
for? Okay. Okay. No, in the beta thal, see, had it been a beta thal, then we would have got, we wouldn't have got HbA2, we would have got HbF being very high. We have beta thal major and beta thal minor. In a beta thal major, we will have very high HbF and very minimal of HbA1. And in minor, sometimes you will have HbA2, but still it wouldn't be so much of a variation.
What?
Okay,
I'll just show you how the interpretation of HP electrophoresis is done. That's why I just thought, as I said, I thought this, I'll just put this case as it is. See, when we do, when we run an electrophoretic pattern, this is the pattern which, this is how we do the electrophoresis. This is the point of application of the sample. Oh, marker comes.
Central one.
It's not working anyway. Okay. The point of application, then the red band which you see here. This is the point of application of the sample. The sample is driven. This is hemoglobin electrophoresis, which is done at an alkaline pH. So that is at a pH of 8. So when it is run here, this is the hemoglobin A1 which you see usually, and which is very normally, it is very a thick band. There are only two hemoglobins which go beyond the hemoglobin A1, that is called as the fast hemoglobins. They are the HB BARTs and the HBH. These are the fast variants. And here, if you have HbA1, HbF is usually seen as a smeared pattern just beyond the HbA1, and this is the carbonic anhydrase enzyme over here. Here at this level, when you do electrophoresis, you have HbA2, HbC, HbE and HbORF, which all come at the same position. In between the HbA1 and the HbA2, usually you have the HbS or the sickle. If at all, if there is sickle, that's where you will get the band. This one? It's not focusing.
So quick, go ahead.
Okay,
go ahead.
Fine, no problem. So in this particular case, we saw a very thick band in HbA2, which was very unlike like a beta thalassemia, because in beta thalassemia, what you would get is more of a HbF. So then we just looked up. So as I said, HbH are the fast variants, BARTs. HbA3, it's a mixture of glycated hemoglobins that doesn't come into the picture. HbS would have been again between HbA2 and HbF, so that's not there at all. What you have is only HbA2 and HbF. Usually in any thalassemia, the HbA2 will not be higher than 10%. And a fetal hemoglobin is here is again more than 15%. That means that probably there is also thalassemia. So there are two variants which we thought of, that was hemoglobin C and hemoglobin E variants. Hemoglobin C is unlikely because it is an autosomal disorder, and here basically it is seen more in African ancestry. Then we looked up at the literature also, and I was very surprised to see that it is a very common hemolytic anemia in the Southeast Asia, and particularly in the northeastern and eastern regions of the country like UP and Bengal, all those sites, it's pretty common. So you have a HbE wherein there is a disposition of the glutamic acid is being replaced by lysine at 26 position. It is the commonest hemoglobin variant in India with a prevalence of 7 to 50%, other than the routine hemoglobins. So, but here usually in manifestations of E, we have come straight to beta thalassemia, but in hemoglobin E, there are variants again of this, carriers, homozygotes. But in carriers and homozygotes, usually the anemia will not be so much. Here we had a very severe anemia. In addition to that, we had microcytosis, we had target cells, and we had hepatosplenomegaly over here. All this indicates that the patient also had a thalassemia in association. So you have a condition which is called as hemoglobin E beta thalassemia. So more likely it was that. But again here, the manifestations include refractory anemia, splenomegaly, unexplained jaundice, and the clinical severity of BEAT is variable, ranging from mild to severe. Then again I gave a call back to them and asking from which part of the country does this girl come from, and then he says, yes, she actually comes from UP, she has come here to study to Bangalore. So that's where she comes from. So this is a very common variant. The management of HbE beta thalassemia is similar to that of homozygous beta thalassemia. Trying to maintain the hemoglobin beyond 7 g/cent, you have to, they may have significant growth retardation, recurrent fractures, significant bony deformities or complications due to extramedullary hepatoposis. But here what I would like to say is, here though we, the, as I said, at the position of A2, I will go to the same slide again, at the position of A2, you have CE. There are two variants which are there, so we have to rule out both of them. So these are the two possibilities. So finally, I gave a report saying there is a possibility of HBE variant or a HBC, more likely a HBE beta thalassemia. What we would really require further to this is a acid electrophoresis, which is done at a citrate at different pH. So that will cause the variation, the electrophoretic pattern will get differentiated between C and E. But that more likely, looking at the clinical picture, from the location from where she comes, everything, it is most likely a HBE beta thalassemia that was there with this case. So we have to keep our minds open that, you know, thinking we are in Bangalore and this condition is not something which is related to us, but I mean, it was really interesting. This just came 2 days before and I thought I'll put it up. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.